Hello and welcome to our Christian Literary Imagination series. This is the 14th event. I can't really believe that in the current series, and actually the last for this academic year, but we will be starting again in the next academic year. The series is sponsored by Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with the Las Casas Institute at Blackfriars Hall, the University of Oxford, and with Campion Hall at the University of Oxford. And today is something of a milestone because we're doing something a little bit different, because we're welcoming Mary Ann Clark, who you'll know as Molly Clark, but we're welcoming her as a poet in her own right. And she's going to be reading some of her poems and talking to us about those poems. You'll remember as Molly Clark, which is her literary critical name, she spoke in the Christian Shakespeare question mark series on the influence of the morality plays. And then we had that wonderful lecture, second wonderful lecture, on in the Christian Literary Imagination series, when she talked about Christopher Smart, the poet with Geoffrey the cat, if you remember. That's what most people, I'm afraid, do remember him about. So we'll be welcoming her to give us a poetry reading. Now, as usual, during our talk, I'll be taking questions from you in the audience, and I encourage you please to ask questions by using your Q&A button at the bottom of the screen, and we'll try to include as many questions as possible at the end of the talk. So please participate. And with that, I'm really anticipating a treat today because I've read the poems and they're absolutely wonderful. So I'm really, really excited about this. So with that, I hand over to you, Molly.
Thank you so much. That's such a kind introduction. And yeah, I'm really grateful to be here. So I'll kick off with a poem straight away. And this poem is called St. When I was small and desperate for sainthood, I walked backwards down streets for a year. Dully inconvenient, but not without peril. Streets and saints, straits between place and place, chaining hand to hand to hand us on to somewhere. Thinking of the old warriors who contorted and were contorted for a cause, the old warriors who couldn't let it go, I couldn't let it. I linked my antics to God. It's fair to say that I was coming at things from the wrong angle. It didn't last because real saints, I think, like streets, see where they need to go and go there. So this is the first poem from my pamphlet, also called St., which is just out recently with the amazing Poetry Press Broken Sleep books. And the poems in the pamphlet are all framed by the perceptions of the speaker from the poem I've just read. Someone who's living in our modern world and trying to navigate the idea of how to be good, how to do good. Within this kind of framing narrative, the pamphlet looks at and ventriloquizes some biblical and some latter-day saints, and also thinks about the saintly and the monstrous. Today I'll read some poems that are from the pamphlet and some that are part of the wider project. As a writer reading the Bible, it's often the people around Jesus that interest me most. People who come into contact with him and are changed by him, with both the joy and the difficulty that brings. Now I'm going to read a poem that I wrote very recently. So it might change as I edit it, but this is it in its current form. It's called Three Women, and it's in three parts. I try to speak in the voice of three different figures from the Gospels who appear in the moment that they come into contact with Jesus. But in this poem, I try to write about them not after they've met Jesus, but before. So this is Three Women. The woman taken in adultery. I had a vision while handing the washed cups to my mother-in-law, thinking about my hands in the thick hair of a man not her son. I will be touched by strangers. There will be something written but I will not see it. I will be alone again with my little wanting heart. The woman at the well. I will go out in the hot noon. There will be no one there. If there is, I will not speak to him. If I do, I will convey nothing. I will be silent on my walk home with the heavy water. The woman with an issue of blood. Up early again from pain, and wood pigeons are treading quietly through the grass. Today I will try one last thing. And the next poem I'll read is called Mary Magdalene in the Wilderness. Having been all that time a monster among men, I, solitude sheathed like a husk held grain, am a flicker whisked up with the licks of dawn and soundly down at dark. Am sand dune, am naked but incredibly hairy. My eating is in a manner external, not for pain or wanting. The middle of nowhere is somewhere, and I am placed on it like a beautiful paperweight. I spoke instead of touching your body and said an entire unto itself story. I never saw you again. I'm wearing silence like a parched land's raining. Seven dead demons is none too little company. Several far friends of whom I think blessedly, though they pulled my heart out. The fullness of fullness and the completion of completion. I am pathless, am holy monster, and my prize will be no more nor less than this. Now I'll read quite an old one, actually, in which we hear from St. Peter, who I'll be sticking with for a while afterwards. And this is called Galilee. We saw you, us naked and two left feet, daybreak, you a bleared blink's freight, a surfacing dream that met us at shore. Your words cut through at the first shear, shucked off our rinds of humdrum despair. Back to your old tricks, we knew you'd disappear again. My brothers pressed you and kissed you, but the boat of my love has never quite crossed you, deep river, merchant of riddles. I ran into the sea, laughing droplets of rain. When I turned around, there you were still, cooking fish on a fire where the water ended. Odd little breakfast, you, smoke balled in your fist. The sun rose, warming deep water and oaths, and our hearts flickered like fire in our mouths. So now I'll read two poems, one about St. Paul and one about St. Peter. And these have to be my two favourite saints. I find them such fascinating and moving figures. They're very different from each other in their social positions and in their relationship to Jesus, and in their methods of spreading the gospel and their kind of their ideas about that. But they have a lot in common too. I find it very poignant that they're both guilty about something from the past. So for Paul, his zealous persecution of Christians before his conversion, and for Peter, his denial of Jesus after the Passion. But by the time we kind of get into the main body of the book of Acts, they're both ultimately confident in the love of Christ. In the poem I'm about to read, I'm particularly interested in Paul's joyful but misplaced confidence in the approach of the end times. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, he says. So this poem is for Paul. I know. It's dark here at last. The night sleeve sweeps over the page of the ground. Here, heavy, the air is still. My heartbeat is tensed for a glorious theft. Nothing left behind. My cries, take them. There's thick fog, my friends. I call to you. I send my soul to the 12-armed road. Waiting sinner, still homecoming. Oh, zenith of this knowing, not knowing of this zenith. Oh, homecoming, still waiting sinner. To the 12-armed road I send my soul, to you I call my friends. There's thick fog behind my cries, take them. Nothing left for a glorious theft. My heartbeat is tensed. The air is still here. Heavy, the rage of the ground sleeps under the dawn, at last. It's dark here, I know, I know. So in that poem, I was attempting to create a form that sort of reversed itself as it went along. And I was inspired by the specular poem, which is a term coined by Julia Coppers, in which the lines repeat to mirror each other. So it would be line A, line B, line C, line B, line A. But I also included reversal within each individual line. I wanted to capture the sense of Paul awaiting the end times and every day having to begin again. My next poem about Peter uses the same form to think about Peter's journey through despair and redemption. And it's called Peter / Basilisk. I knew you all along, my best beheld, my only one. And everybody knows that I'm the reason. Slight as love, as strong, and never right enough not to be wrong. When the cock crows, take me. My skin is candid as a night-long coal, and I am past forgiving. I look you in the eye, and it is finished. It's finished, and I look you in the eye. Forgiving, and I am past as a night-long coal. My skin is candid when the cock crows. Take me, never wrong enough not to be right, as strong as love, as slight, and I'm the reason that everybody knows. My only one, my best beheld, I knew you all along. While I was writing these poems, I was very interested in the saint and the monster, and the saintly and the monstrous. And I was interested in the idea that the saintly can tip over into the monstrous, both in historical reality and in popular perception. The next poem looks at a series of latter-day saints, and I picked ones who were somehow monstrous or were perceived in that way. And this is called Hagiography. I saw Christopher, I saw of a man, giant arm span, head of a dog, hefting his harm about. I saw him, all quiver and readiness, stand in the river. Christopher, carry the Christ child across, milk mild held in your hideous jaws. I wish you could carry my child like that weight of love was more than the world. Ursula, the sea wind sting-lashed her hair into my face. Thin-wristed, abashed-ankled sea monster with her seething coral of virgins. She displaced the water, travelling as fast as the earth. Her kiss was a sea urchin. Schoolgirls running into the wind. You stayed out too late. You wet your feet too fully in the spouseless sea. You knew too much and too little. Now you are sent up. Now you are laid in your small beds. Simeon Stylites, high-rise triptease. I saw him, I think, like a mote in the eye, a beetle on a stem, a giant on a diet. There are eyes on stalks at sigh on his stalk. His vertebrae walk stepwise to the clouds, his eyes shut in the silence of air, of prayer. You have taught us many things of use and sluiced us with wisdom from on high. But come down, your mother, your mother. One walked down a hill towards me, head in hands, his head, his hands. They unstopped you, Dennis, like a bottle, but you were for a while unstoppable, leisurely. I heard you preach, taking measured steps and cradling that kind jaw so casually, almost as if those wine-sweet words you poured to the lees for us could come any time, but it might as well be now. I saw one who gave the poor her dowry, as would have been. To the widow, a word and a flowery fist of dough, a spice cake and a sharp look to the orphan. Lucy, lead weight, dead weight to the hands. The men and their taut-necked oxen couldn't pull you from the place where your sensible shoe was planted, rooted as deep as the heart. For you had the art of God's own inconvenience, the snowfall, the floodplain, the leaves on the line. Oh, pray for me that I be a hindrance. Oh, give me the strength to be dully, doltishly, phlegmatically, blockishly, beautifully, immovable. I saw I don't know what, and it was Claire, cropped hair, head like a knuckle bone, girl who had everything, chose to have nothing. Father loses a daughter, and next thing she's all over the town like a map. What a sight! Barefoot and skin drawn tight as a cold snap, all shoulder blades and silence crouched in the doorways. But when you walked out with nothing but the sacrament to the edge of town, past the last houses, and stood watching, I thought you were perfect. And when the approaching army saw you, they turned back and ran without knowing why. The next one that I'll read is also a bit of a longer one, and it's called The Diary of St. Morand, and it's kind of divided into a week for each sonnet, and it's about a French monk who supposedly fasted through Lent living on a single bunch of grapes. So this is Diary of St. Morand. No, this is not a crisis. It's a seed that sends a root right through the stones and through the soil to nourishment too deep for greed. I'm ready now, I feel, to suffer you, the sufferer at my plenteous feast, always until now a disruption, with your tears and sudden laughter when I looked for praise. You're not beneath, I not above your jeers. I tell you in the vineyards, while out walking in thick and flowery dusk, when you're there hidden between the sinews of the branches, stalking. I write my sainthood like the rain, unbidden. You haven't shown by any grand display that you approve. I'll do it anyway. I told the brothers. Jean said I'd have died by Mothering Sunday latest. Said I shouldn't be so melodramatic. I replied that I'd be subtle, and besides, he wouldn't be called upon to watch me. Keeping body and soul together, not, in fact, my object. To grow beyond the clutter and the clod, he, with clicks of tongue, went off to lunch. Prospect of isolation, part of the attraction. Oh, seed within me, once cut free from slough of tares and briars, grow to satisfaction until I meet the gardener you knew. No more of fruitless fasts. Might this be how we could begin to know each other now? Like itching out of reach, like thundering fire that eats away the forest and its haze of wavy, nerveless heat. Just like desire and just like rank aversion. These last days I've spent in pacing. Gah, my putrid breath not even sound for psalms. I'm never not about the task of feeling this quick death. Like rebel branches hollowed out by rot, and everything of nothing like the wind, a positive of negative. banal yet fiercely shocking, like an ankle skinned. A thousand achings cramped in a corral. Your face shines in the grape's reflective skin. I've lost myself out walking. Let me in. This week I was primarily in bed. Was short with girl who came to gather stones, spoke sour to her. Sweet Jesus, I said. It had been a good sleep when skin and bones she came and scatterfooted past outside. Yes, sweet was a true word. Presses the lips almost to closing. Pressed, you liquefied a something of yourself. It seeped in drips onto the world's parched tongue. What kinds of wine would you all be? That was Brer Max that night at dinner. Ha, yes, fun conceit. I, swine, said nothing. Should have said, quite dry. That might have been a witticism. Serving man, full-bodied, passed a leer and carved the ham. I dreamt that I was tangled in the vine, two nights ago or naps ago. Small pains. My body, yes, unquestionably mine, is there and there, between the thick green chains, absurdly bulging and obtruding out, tumescent, damp and ruddy. Hot cheeks, shame. Now soil in mouth, arms weakly flung about and stretching, growing. Legs, too many, came at angles from my trunk. I felt a weight of palpitating grapes and pride. But now, the small correcting nicks, the huger bite that wrestled to the earth each deadbeat bough. Half watching still, you knew. I, bud-like, cried all down your stem-like heart. You said, abide. I laugh and cry in mirrors at myself. You laugh and cry with me. The things I want are put away for now on a high shelf. I think they are the following: to haunt you and to speak at length with you, to take the sunshine with you, swallow down the rain, to be a fruitful branch and never slake my reaching thirst for you and you again. I don't know anything, taken to lying down on the ground a lot. Now everything is just a bit too much, each task too trying and yet too small to bother, close to nothing. There's someone there to meet me in my nullness. Amen, amen. You, life in all its fullness. And I'll finish now with the last poem in the pamphlet, which is called How to Be Good. I saw I don't know what, and it's the moon. It's almost night and almost home, and it's there, stepping backwards, bigger now than ever, slap bang above the middle of the street. Like anything's worth trying when the world's involved. So many people are involved. I'm considering my approach to love and hate, and how to get all the embracing done and all the fighting done. I'm worrying about how little of it all I've done. But if I ever climb this holy hill, I'll be so glad to see the way the dark laps at the moon. Like how when I was small and tried imagining the universe, I could only see the rough-edged blue-black wash to which, with a brush, a little more might be added when I could, a little more. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Molly. That's terrific. What a privilege, you know, to hear these poems, some of them for the first time in today's event. Let me start with something that came in from Susan Wolfe, who says, "Love this work. Please give me the name of the pamphlet and where I might publish it." Publisher? I live in London, UK, and would very much like to read it further and share it with friends who love poetry and these stories as well. Thank you, Susan Wolfe. And then she adds, I'm from Wyoming, but live in London. So we'll try and make sure that everybody who's participated today gets the information about your pamphlet. I think that's probably the best thing to do, and how they can purchase it. But reading them beforehand, I was just quite amazed at their apparent simplicity and yet the complexity of their composition. I just wonder how do you start in terms of deciding on the topic and then deciding on how you want to present it?
Yeah, that's interesting. And I think, yeah, this is an interesting one to ask, because I think probably every poet will say something different. So in terms of the topic, I do tend to find that I have particular things that I get obsessed with, and I write lots of poems on that topic, and I find it quite hard to write about anything else, even if I try. So yeah, for the past few years, it has been saints and biblical figures that have kind of been most fascinating me. And, you know, sometimes, yeah, even with any other than that, as you see, I often find myself returning to the same people, so to Peter particularly. So I think it's almost, in terms of choosing the topic, it's almost like a compulsion. I mean, sometimes you can choose what you want to write about and sort of get started that way, but that I don't find that so easy. In terms of starting on the poem itself, I kind of find that it has to be, I have to have a sort of a hook into it. So it will be a phrase that will come to me, or a particular image, or a particular kind of angle I want to take it from. And that's my way into it. I find it hard just to kind of start directly, sort of think this is what I want to write about and then go for it. I mean, yeah, I think that there are things that poetry needs to say, that poets need to say, things that are important, but not very many poets. I mean, only a kind of a skillful few can say those things directly, and I'm definitely not one of them. I mean, Emily Dickinson said, "Tell all the truth, but tell it slant," didn't she? And I mean, that's kind of my approach, I suppose, or kind of what I try to make my approach, is that I will sort of come to the things I want to say sort of from the side. And I suppose my aim would be to kind of create an environment within my poems that puts the reader or listener into the frame of mind to hear important things that need to be said, even if they're not said by me, if they're said by people who know more about it. So I suppose I want my poems to put people into a frame of mind that's sort of open and attentive to detail and sort of generous-hearted. And I feel that's kind of how poetry can sort of try to do good in the world. So yeah, that's kind of my method and my aspiration, I suppose.
Yes, you seem to be able to do that and get the line just right. You see where you want to go and go there. You know, you're just able to do that. Or in that first Sunt poem, it didn't last because real saints, I think, like streets, see where they need to go and go there. You know, it seems to me that you've, I don't know whether those were the hooks, but they certainly are the lines that kind of sum up what's going on in the whole of the poem, which is really very, very beautiful, actually, in the simplicity of the language. Do you have to work a great deal at that, or?
Yeah, I mean, what I really, really love in poetry generally, but which and which I try to do myself, but which is often hard and can't be forced, is I love the kind of the nomic voice, I suppose, you know, when poets say something that sounds very simple but is also very true. And I particularly like that sort of within a more sort of intricate, complex texture. So I suppose I love poems that are kind of quite densely packed in their imagery, but then amongst that you have these kind of clear nomic utterances kind of coming through. So I suppose that's kind of what I aim for. I aim for simplicity within intricacy. But I mean, yeah, it's not necessarily easy to think of these truths. So I guess that does have to be there in the incipience of the poem. That has to be there from the start, and you have to have something to say, I suppose, and that's where it comes from. But often it will be quite a random bit that hooks me into it. It's not necessarily always the main, what ends up being the sort of main resonance of the poem. It can be just a phrase or an image, as I say.
But there's sometimes there are images that that conjure up other things. So in the Simeon poem, for example, just those final words, your mother, just conjures up so many kind of different images. You might think of Christ on the cross and looking down to your mother, you know. Or you might think of, in my case, I think of Coriolanus, oh mother, mother, what have you done? You know, that this kind of just in those simplicity of the words, and also of course in the image, because they've got Simeon up on his pillar, you know, for however many years, 30 odd years, living on top of a pillar as a hermit.
Yeah. So I think that kind of stemmed from something I read about Simeon, who's in some ways quite a sort of comic figure in this kind of very extreme way of life, but I think I read something about how he didn't come down for his mother's funeral or when she was ill or something like that, and I think it's there's an interesting kind of thing about saintly people in that, you know, sometimes they appear to sort of have their eye on the bigger picture, and they kind of they can sort of hurt those that love them, and they can hurt themselves as well, which is something I'm kind of interested in. So exploring that kind of connection between sainthood and the monstrous. That was really interesting, those allusions. As you say, the Coriolanus one is interesting. I mean, I hadn't thought of it, to be honest, but that is interesting because, you know, with it's the opposite situation, I guess, in Coriolanus's mother kind of manages to talk him down, I suppose. But it's the opposite with Simeon. As you say, I suppose Simeon is trying, I suppose, to echo the distance of Christ from the ground during the crucifixion, that kind of distance, but taken to an extreme in Simeon's case.
Yes, that leads on to another question that came. This is such a secular age. I don't know who set this one in, but it says, this is such a secular age. And I suppose the Coriolanus thing is that it hasn't got the spirituality to it. It is secular. It's to do with politics, mothers, relationships, and so on. So it's going to work. It's going to work the other way within the love of the mother. But this person says, such a secular age. I'm interested in your choice of the Bible as the source of poetic inspiration.
I really think the Bible is one of my main inspirations, really. So I had a Christian upbringing. Ever since I was born, I was going to church, and I think So it's kind of very obviously, you know, in a way, similarly to poets from the past, I always had, you know, those characters, that language, and those images sort of quite near to me. So it was kind of natural that I would draw on that. But kind of even more broadly than that, I think almost my emotions are sort of partly formed by hearing the Bible so frequently, because I mean, I was lucky enough to have a very happy, peaceful childhood. So some of my first experiences of things like betrayal and bereavement were actually focalized through the characters of the Bible and of the Gospels particularly. So I kind of, and that's obviously very important as a poet, you know, what has shaped your perceptions and your emotional development. And you know, obviously on the happy side as well, some very kind of crystalline happy memories, and joyful memories of, you know, things like singing hymns and psalms and carols. A lot of the kind of striking points of emotion and feeling and sort of sensory overload, I suppose, are shaped by the Bible and by a Christian upbringing. But I mean, I really think that in sort of English speaking world, I mean, we and beyond, you know, we frequently see poets using the Bible who aren't Christians themselves. I mean, just because there's a certain amount to which it still does, I think, seep into cultural consciousness. You know, even in a kind of fairly secular society. But yeah, I think, yeah, it'll be I suppose interesting to see how that declines. I mean, obviously for none of us, you know, including for me, we don't have the same, you know, amazing recall of moments from the Bible, you know, like for example with Paul Edmondson's talk earlier in the series about Shakespeare's biblical allusion, you know, just these incredibly specific phrases from the Bible that we just know would have been in everyone's heads. That's not the case now, even for me, I'm sure. But no, the Bible has definitely shaped my literary development for sure.
Let me just say a couple of things coming in here. Juan Pablo Cervantes says, beautiful poems, congratulations, many, many thanks. And Julia Gurney says exactly the same, beautiful poems, powerful simplicity, congratulations. But let me just go on to take that a little further, because Catherine Temple has asked, could you talk about the intersections between your academic work and the poetry? How does creativity figure in each of these areas?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. So I'm just kind of in the last year of my DPhil thesis. I'm just finishing off in English literature, and I work on rhyme in Shakespeare's theatre. So I actually primarily work on drama rather than page poetry, which I suppose is interesting in itself in the way that it makes me think about voice, which is very important for poetry, even though we're not really in an oral culture anymore in our society. So I'm thinking about rhyme all the time, and the incredibly varied ways with which Shakespeare uses rhyme. So in the kind of period before Shakespeare, drama was in continuous rhyme. It would, you know, every line would be rhymed. It would all be within kind of schemes of verse form. So you would never hear a line that wasn't rhymed in most plays. But by the time we get to the early modern period and Shakespeare's plays, rhyme has become, I describe it as a sort of a special effect. You know, it's something that is reserved for particular purposes, and it would have called up a huge range of very, very different associations for people. So some quite highbrow, like historical poetry, or quite lowbrow, like improvised clown performances. And And also it would kind of hark back to that earlier theatre. So yeah, so what I'm saying is rhyme is used not as a kind of blanket texture, but as a specially deployed tool. And that's something that I try to think about a lot in my own poetry as well. Most of my poems will kind of be using something that could be described as rhyme, sort of somewhere or another, some kind of repetition of sound. And yeah, I'm very interested in sort of in half rhymes as well. I'm trying to deploy that in interesting ways. But I'm not very often writing in, you know, conventional rhyme schemes, although the Diary of St. Morand poem that I'm reading, that I read, was a sonnet sequence. So that does use, a form that would have been familiar to Shakespeare. But so I suppose that's one aspect of it. Then in terms of the two different mindsets, I guess is perhaps more what you were asking about, actually. So I think I'll try to have them actually not as separate as you might think. So because my thesis is kind of primarily based in close reading or kind of formalism, although it is a sort of rooted in a kind of historical approach, but I'm kind of wanting to look at the effect that Shakespeare's rhymes have and what they're doing in a poetic sense and in a kind of associational sense. So I almost sort of try to have my sort of poetry writing brain switched on almost when I'm doing that. I sometimes think maybe I'm more of a poet than a critic, really, for better or for worse. That tends to be my way in to texts, is to look at them from that angle. So I think they do intersect. I mean, I find writing poetry to be probably the hardest thing I ever attempt to do. It's these, any of ones that you've heard tonight are the result of a lot of anguish and discarded attempts and whatnot. So in a way, critical writing is, though also very, very hard, is almost a more kind of relaxing form of writing, I suppose, and one that I'm kind of able to sort of sustain regardless of my mood or what's going on. If I have to meet a deadline, then I can churn out a chapter. but with poetry, it's a bit more elusive and difficult to to pin down. Those are some of the differences and similarities in my approaches.
Thanks for that. Very interesting. I wish I could be like that with my academic work. I just fill the bin over and over again, but never mind. Chapter after chapter goes somewhere. Anyway, Cecilia Hatt. Hi, Cecilia. Thanks for joining us today. Cecilia joins, I think, being practically at every single one of these to the whole year. And she says, thank you for your poems, which I was previously almost completely unacquainted. My impression is that you describe the condition of the single individual directly or indirectly addressing Christ. Is that right? Because in your Newdigate poem, Sinai, you evoke a group, a generally bothered group, but still compelled to be together. And I found this very attractive and powerful.
Oh, that's wonderful to hear. Thank you so much. That's really interesting. So my poems, as you say, often have a speaker in the first person and then a you, and very, very often that you is some person of the Trinity. So in the Newdigate poem that you mentioned, Sinai, it's God. And then, you know, in quite a lot of the ones that I read tonight, it's Jesus. That's very interesting, that transition, I suppose, between the collective communal voice addressing God, this sort of quite, you know, the God of Exodus is quite a, this poem was about the flight from the Hebrews traveling from Egypt and kind of searching for the Promised Land, because it's based on the book of Exodus. That scriptural tradition. And the God of Exodus is quite a distant one, you know. He sometimes sort of comes in and does these very startling things.
I think it's also, you seem as if you can get into the character. I think this is what Celia was saying as well, like you as an individual can empathize with the character, whether it's, you know, whatever the character happens to be, the situation, almost like an actor being able to empathize with the character. So the one with the three women, the different characters of the three women, each having their own problems, you're able to get an emotional empathy with them, I thought, within the context of the writing.
That's great. And I think perhaps my writing has become more about the individual as I've gone along, really. I mean, when I was sort of first trying to write poems when I was like a young teenager, I found it difficult to write about myself. I was trying to be T.S. Eliot or whatever. So I was quite often writing poems in the voice of, you know, an elderly man or something. I didn't really know much about the experience of such a person, but I was sort of felt that was the voice I needed to have to be a poet. And then I sort of, as I wrote more poetry, I sort of managed to be able to convey my own voice. And then recently, I think I've kind of, I suppose, learnt from both and have, increasingly been writing these poems from the perspectives of individuals. And I think the Gospels are really a great sort of source of inspiration for that, because you do get these incredibly walk-on parts, you know, these characters that appear so briefly but leave such a strong impression. A passage I was just so moved by recently that sort of came up in the lectionary, about the Apostle Philip meeting an Ethiopian eunuch, and they just have a really, really brief conversation about the gospel, and then they just sort of jump into the river and Philip baptizes the eunuch, and then he's gone and disappears, and it's kind of so joyful, and you so get the sense of those individuals and their interaction, but it's just it's gone and never this character never appears again. So I think actually the Bible is a great inspiration for taking, you know, drawing a character in a very small quantity of words. That's really interesting, actually. I'd like to think about it more, really. I mean, obviously, as you say, the dramatic monologue thing is a kind of an actorly thing.
Mike Collins at Georgetown. Hi, Mike. Be a help here, because he says in the spiritual exercises, St. Ignatius instructs the person who is engaged in the exercises to imagine in detail the people and events of scripture to create a recognizable human context. These poems seem to actualize deftly and insightfully what Ignatius envisions. And I think that's what you've been saying. You're trying to get there. It comes down to, you know, this is the last event for this series of the Christian literary imagination, and I'm really grateful for Georgetown for saying that we can carry on with a new series next year. But it comes down to this idea of what the Christian imagination is, you know. And I just felt that by reading your own poems, you might be able to tell us about your sense of what the Christian literary imagination is.
So obviously, we've heard a huge kind of range of definitions and applications of that idea over the past series. So, I mean, yeah, as I say, sometimes very direct, you know, in like, you know, the specific biblical allusions used by Shakespeare, and then sometimes something a bit more biographical, like Elizabeth Barrett Browning's sort of denominational background and how that influenced her thought and the moral force of her poems. And then I talked about Christopher Smart and his sort of alphabetical imagination and how he kind of uses letters and sound to kind of celebrate God's creation. It means a lot of things to a lot of people. For me, I would say that I experience the Christian literary imagination as a kind of imagination in which the sort of the figures and events of the gospel are as alive and as present to me as the real figures and events around me. It's that sort of alive in my mind in that way. And so if you have that kind of imagination, that will influence what you say, and it will influence who you say it to and who you say it about. And it will also influence, obviously, the language that in which you naturally find yourself saying it, because it's that kind of biblical language. I actually think Mike Collins's comment is, yeah, a really kind of beautiful one for this as well, that, you know, it's about having the sort of the life of Christianity sort of living in your mind, and how that impacts on what you write as a poet. For me, that would be my definition of it.
Thanks for that. Vani Capideo says, beautiful work, thank you. What are some of your favourite sources for saints' lives? And are there saints you haven't written about who would like to?
Hello, Vani. That's a great question. I'm sort of woefully underread on saints, really. I hope this will be a kind of constant learning in my life. Vani is an eminent medievalist, so I'm on shaky ground here, but kind of my reading of sort of in back in my undergrad of sort of medieval writing was often quite inspirational on that. So for example, the kind of idea behind my little bit about St. Christopher, in which I describe him as having the head of a dog, was sort of inspired by something we read in the Noel Codex, which is the sort of manuscript or whatever that contains Beowulf, but it also has these other things in it. There was this rendering of St. Christopher as having the head of a dog, but actually it's thought that was actually a misreading, that he's a Canaanite, but they read that as Canaanite or something. I think that's interesting. I feel like I will probably keep writing about saints unstoppably. So if anyone has saints that they think could use a poem, then please send them my way.
Yeah, okay. You might pray for that. Somebody sent you one down. Yes, okay. Savannah Willard, she actually asks, how do you refine the work after the first draft and so on, which I think you've touched on already, but just to say hello, she says, hello, your work is extraordinarily beautiful, ask you to talk about the process of writing, but I think you've done that. I wonder whether, Molly, just to end, you might like to read Sunt again, if you've got it handy, because that's rather nice. And then I'll give the usual thanks and notices of what is to come in the future. Okay.
Great. I will. And yeah, thank you everyone so much for your questions and really, really kind comments. I'm so happy to hear them. This is Sunt. When I was small and desperate for sainthood, I walked backwards down streets for a year, dully inconvenient, but not without peril. Streets and saints, straits between place and place, chaining hand to hand to hand us on to somewhere. Thinking of the old warriors who contorted and were contorted for a cause, the old warriors who couldn't let it go, I couldn't let it. I linked my antics to God. It's fair to say that I was coming at things from the wrong angle. It didn't last because real saints, I think, like streets, see where they need to go and go there.
I think that's absolutely beautiful. Terrific. Well, thank you very much. This has been a very special event. And we've been talking and we've been doing it in a certain formula, Joe Simmons and myself. And we just thought, right, we'd love to have some writers who actually do a session with us. And you're the first to have done this, Mary Ann Clark, Molly. So we're delighted. And it's been, I can tell from what people are saying, it's been such a great success. And I'm very pleased to say that Dana Joya, the American novelist, is going to do a similar session with his fiction in December, which we look forward to. This is the last of the series for this term, as I've said, but we will be back with this second series, and that'll start on October the 12th with a talk by Professor Catherine Temple. Catherine actually feeds the questions to me. So I fed a question to her. Why not do one yourself? So she is, and she's interested in Defoe and Fielding. So that's going to be a very interesting one to start off. And then in October, we have another one already lined up on October the 26th with Professor John Hirsch from Georgetown, who's going to be talking to us about Chaucer. As far as the Free Speech Project is concerned, this is Free Speech at a Crossroads International Dialogues. They're going to continue through the summer. They're a monthly event. And the next one is going to be on the 17th of June at 4 p.m. UK time, 11 a.m. US time. This is going to deal with endangered species. And I know that one of the speakers will be Lord Peter Hayne, who's got a particular interest about the white rhino and the dangers to the white rhino, and who's going to be speaking for the white rhino. So that'll be on the 17th of June. We've got three other excellent speakers that day. And we've also got one on business ethics on the 19th of July. And just before starting today, I had an email from David Jones, MP, used to be the Secretary of State for Wales and a member of David Cameron's cabinet. And he's agreed to speak about business ethics. And we'll have a team around him as well, another three excellent speakers. We know who we're going to ask now, another three excellent speakers for that. So that's on the 17th of June, then the 19th of July. And in August, we haven't decided exactly the date, but I think that's going to be on free speech in terms of religion, which would be very interesting. So we're looking forward to the new term. Thanks, Molly, again, for an absolutely fabulous afternoon. I'd like to thank sincerely my co-convener of the series, Joe Simmons, who's like Molly, beavering away at his Oxford DPhil, and hopefully we'll be able to submit it soon. But has also spent energy, like Molly has, in helping us through the course of this term and this academic year. thank you all for being part of this. There's no point doing it without an audience, and the questions have been remarkable, and the attention that you've shown, and also the commitments fortnight by fortnight in joining us throughout this the series. Thanks for all of you who've submitted questions. I'd like to thank those at Georgetown University who've helped to make this happy, especially our administrator, Yvonne Quek, whom we congratulate on getting a master's in business administration last week and graduating in that. So well done. How you've done that and organised us at the same time, I do not know, Yvonne, but many, many thanks for all your work. Catherine Temple, who's been feeding me the questions, but also helps in terms of discussing what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And it's been helping us to formulate next year's events. I'd like to thank Nick Austin, who's the Master of Campion Hall at Oxford, and Sarah Gray and Ying Ying, Campion Hall administrators. Richard Finn, the Director of the Las Casas Institute, and Dr. John O'Connor, the Regent of Blackfriars Hall. Las Casas is part of Blackfriars Hall of the University of Oxford. And Kinga Rona Gavin, our UK administrator. At Georgetown, well, without this, without the support of Jack DeJoy, the President, and Tom Banchoff, the Vice President of Global Affairs, these events would not take place. And we're absolutely so grateful to them both. And finally, again, my thanks to you for being part of the audience. Please join us again on the 17th of June, the 19th of July, 12th of October. In the meantime, take care, keep safe, and have a lovely summer. I gather the sun is shining in the US now, as it is shining here in the Lake District where I happen to be at the moment. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter @MikeScottProf. Thank you. And goodbye.